5 days after Buller reached Ladysmith, Gattaca occupied Stormberg. And on March the 13th, Roberts entered the undefended Free State capital of Bloemfontein. For the Boers, any hopes of a decisive victory were now beginning to evaporate. Roberts was to remain in Bloemfontein for 6 weeks. Initially, this was seen as a period of consolidation, rest, and resupply. The troops were exhausted, their uniforms were tattered, and their boots disintegrating on their feet. The cavalry needed new horses, and the army in general needed fresh supplies of ammunition and field rations for the troops. Problems of supply had become chronic the further north the army had advanced. Bloemfontein marked the effective limit of the first stage of that advance, and its single-track railway link to the Cape provided an increasingly tenuous and congested supply line. The town itself suffered from a congestion that completely overwhelmed both the water supply and the rudimentary sanitation system. A typhoid epidemic swept through the camps clustered on the arid veldt around Bloemfontein. By the beginning of April, the epidemic had claimed over 1,000 lives and was to rage intermittently for the remainder of the conflict. Of the 20,000 British troops who were to lose their lives in the Boer War, more than half would die of typhoid. The early months of 1900 also saw the first opening shots in the second phase of the war. In February, the Free State leader, Christian de Wet, had seized a convoy of 200 wagons at Waterval Drift. In March, de Wet had surprised another supply column at Corn Spruit, 20 miles outside Bloemfontein, capturing over 100 wagons, more than 400 prisoners, and 7 guns. In April, de Wet struck again, at Reddersburg and at Weppene, taking a further 600 captives before being driven off by relief columns from Robert's main army. Although dismissed at the time as the last desperate actions of a defeated enemy, the raids marked the beginning of the guerrilla war, an increasingly bitter conflict that would persist for a further 2 years. On May the 17th, Mafeking was at last relieved by flying columns from the north and south. On the 24th, the Free State was formally incorporated as a dependent territory of the British Empire. 2 days later, the first units of Robert's colossal army reached the Vaal and began advancing through the Transvaal towards Johannesburg. Five days later, Roberts reached Johannesburg, capturing the gold mines and the deserted commercial capital of the Rand. On June the 5th, Roberts entered Pretoria. He found it, like Johannesburg, largely deserted and undefended. At the end of May, Kruger had abandoned the capital, fleeing with the remnants of his government to the Mozambique frontier. In September, he would sail for Europe, never to return. Throughout the first southern winter of the war, from May through to August, Buller advanced steadily, elbowing his way through the Drakensberg and over the Natal passes. In contrast with his earlier battles on the Tugela, Buller's new methods were a model of economy and effectiveness. At every tortuous twist and turn, he outmaneuvered Botha, conserving his forces and driving the Boers out onto the far less defensible plains of the eastern Transvaal. At the end of August, Buller fought the last set-piece battle of the war. The remnants of Botha's army, still some 7,000 strong, had entrenched themselves along a line of hills, ridges and ravines commanding the railway line connecting the Transvaal to the Mozambique frontier and the coast. In the center of the range, one hill proved the tactical key to Botha's position. Using the by now well-practiced techniques of tightly coordinated artillery and infantry assaults, Buller seized the hill at minimal cost, thereby collapsing the entire Boer front and precipitating Kruger's subsequent flight into exile. For the next 2 months, Buller's forces advanced through the eastern Transvaal, chasing a dispirited and disintegrating Boer army from redoubt to redoubt. In a string of engagements among the ravines and escarpments of the northern Drakensberg, Buller's veterans suffered less than 100 casualties. It was all so very different in the West. Roberts had not defeated the Free State Army or the Boer forces in the Western Transvaal. He had merely swept them aside, believing that the capture of their capitals would compel the Boers to surrender. It was a fatal error of judgment. The Boers were not an urban people and had no European sentimentality for their towns. Even the formal annexation of the Transvaal in October 1900 failed to impress upon them that the war was lost. As the great columns lumbered over the veldt or toiled along the tracks of the railway, they encountered almost no resistance to their passage. In their wake, the Boer commandos struck savagely. Attacking garrisons, snapping up convoys, cutting the rail and telegraph lines, and riding away with as much plunder as they could carry. By now, many of the commandos were equipping themselves with captured British weapons. The perilous and sometimes dilapidated state of Robert's supply lines ensured them a ready supply of ammunition. In a raid on the rail station at Rudeval, De Wet captured so much equipment that after loading his horses and wagons and even his prisoners with booty, he was forced to put to the torch a surplus worth almost £500,000. At the end of the year, Buller and Roberts left for London. Roberts to be awarded a peerage and to be appointed Commander-in-Chief of the Army in succession to Wolseley. Buller to be made a scapegoat for the humiliations of the previous year. The new Commander-in-Chief of Britain's forces in the region and the man charged with rounding up the remaining renegades was General Kitchener. Kitchener had earned a reputation in the Sudan for vigorous and determined leadership. He had served as Robert's chief of staff during the long march from Cape Town to Pretoria. He knew the country and the people. Yet it was to take Kitchener a further 18 months to bring the war to an end. Throughout the long South African summer, from November 1900 through to March 1901, the Boer commandos ranged with seeming impunity over the veldt. De Wet in the Free State now renamed the Orange River Colony, Louis Botha in the Eastern Transvaal, and Coos de la Rey in the mountain ranges of the West.